Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So we continue with our tafsir of Surah Baqarah. We'll begin with verse number 14 today. As we said in the previous weeks, we're in the middle of the discussion of the description, attributes, actions of the hypocrites, the munafiqun. And as I mentioned the previous week, that the munafiqun, the situation in Medina was that the Prophet ﷺ, his following and his companions and the deen of Islam was gaining in strength and gaining in popularity. So there were a group of people who wanted to benefit for their own personal interests by staying with the Muslims, pretending to be Muslims, but at the same time, they were hiding their nifaq, they were hiding their hypocrisy, they were actually disbelievers, they were not Muslims. They pretended to be Muslims, but they were actually colluding with the enemies of the believers. So we continue with those verses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَى شَيَاطِينِهِمْ قَالُوا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْتَهْزِئُونَ اللَّهُ يَسْتَهْزِئُ بِهِمْ وَيَمُدُّهُمْ فِي طُغْيَانِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ أُولَئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوا الضَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَى فَمَا رَبِحَتْ تِجَارَتُهُمْ وَمَا كَانُوا مُهْتَدِينَ مَثَلُهُمْ كَمَثَلِ الَّذِي اسْتَوْقَدَ نَارًا فَلَمَّا أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ ذهب الله بنورهم وتركهم في ظلمات لا يبصرون صم بكم عمي فهم لا يرجعون. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when they meet, or when they're in front of the believers, they say amanna. وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا, they say we believe, we're like you, we believe, we have faith, we're Muslims. And then what happens, وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَىٰ شَيَاطِينِهِمْ, but when they go to their private meetings with their shayateen, with the leaders of the enemies of the believers, they say, إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْتَهْزِئُونَ. They say to the opposite group, we're with you, we were just playing and mocking the believers, we're not really Muslims, we're on your side. So they're having this double face, if you like. They're going to the believers and saying, we're just like you, we're believers, we're Muslims, we're with you, we've got your back. And then they go to the enemies of the believers and those who are plotting and planning against the Muslim group, say that we are with you. In reality, we're not with the believers, we're simply mocking them, we are playing with them, we're taking them for a ride. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allahu yastahzi'u bihim wa yamudduhum fi tughyanihim ya'mahun. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mocks them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mocks the hypocrites. And He extends them, He increases them, allows them to wander blindly in their disobedience and their transgression. They are the ones, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوا الضَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَىٰ. They are the ones who have purchased misguidance in place of guidance. They have purchased dalala instead of huda. فَمَا رَبِحَتْ تِجَارَتُهُمْ وَمَا كَانُوا مُهْتَدِينَ. Therefore their transaction, their deal, their bargain that they made has not profited them at all, and they have not been guided. So here in the beginning, and the rest of the verses, inshallah, we'll translate when we get to it. Let's start off with وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, verse number 14. So here are the hypocrites. When they come to the believers, they're very, very determined to ensure that the Muslims think that they are believers. So when someone has a doubt, when someone knows they're lying, when someone knows they're tricking somebody, they go that extra yard, extra bit, they do the extra effort to do what? To prove the opposite, to prove that they are believers. So they are declaring that amanna. No, the Muslims, they don't have to declare it all the time. People who are submitted to Islam, the Prophet ﷺ knows them, the Sahaba know them. But if you've got doubt in your own mind, and you know you are trying to mock and deceive people, then you work that extra hard to try and establish and show that you are believers, that you are with the Muslims. So this is why, وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا. They say, when they meet the believers, they say, we have believed. We're just like you. We are Muslims. And this is what the munafiqun used to do. They used to do extra to show, like even when the Prophet ﷺ, he would come to give a nasiha or speech, one of the munafiqun would get up and say, everybody listen. Listen to what the messenger has to say. Listen carefully. You know, proving that he's so much beloved to the Prophet ﷺ. And in another place in the Quran, as the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they say that we bear witness that you are indeed the messenger of Allah. The hypocrites, they are saying, we bear witness that you are the messenger of Allah to the Prophet ﷺ. And Allah replies straight away that Allah bears witness that they are the liars. Allah knows, He bears witness that this is the messenger, but He also bears witness that these hypocrites, they are lying. So this is their nature. They go out of their way to overemphasize and to prove that they're part of the Muslim, part of the believers, so that there's no doubt amongst the others, other believers. But وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَى شَيَاطِينِهِمْ. But when they go, خَلَوْا comes from the word خَلْوَى. خَلْوَى is to be in a private gathering. But here it means when they go to be in a private gathering with the shayateen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls these people shayateen. He didn't name them. He didn't say, these are the leaders of this tribe, of this faith, or this group. He just called them shayateen. And the word shaytan comes from two possible root words. One is shata yashitu, which means the one who is destroyed, the one who's perished. It also means the one who is in haste. It also means the one who is burnt or burning. The other root word is from shatana, the one who is distant from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So look at these root meanings of the word itself. It gives you a description of who these people are. It gives you the description of shaitan himself. But anyone else who follows in his footsteps will be burning in the hellfire, will be always in a haste and rushing, will be the one who is destroyed, the one who perishes, and will be distant from the mercy and iman to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, distant from obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when these hypocrites go to these leaders who encompass all of these descriptions, what do they say? قَالُوا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْتَهْزِئُونَ. We're with you. We're on your side. We were just pretending. We're mocking these people. We're with you. Let's plan how we can destroy these people. This is the nature of the munafiq. And the word munafiq comes from the word nafaqa, which is a lizard's hole which has two exits. So the lizard goes inside the hole. If something is chasing the lizard, like a dog or a fox, it always has two routes to escape from. Either this hole, or it's like a tunnel, it has another exit or entrance. So it always has its options open. If A doesn't work, B is there. This is the munafiq. He's keeping both options open. The only reason they accepted Islam outwardly is to keep their options open, is to benefit from the Muslims, is to have their lives and wealth protected, is to be on the winning side, is to be on the successful side. They don't really believe, but out of their personal interest, that they're keeping their options open. If the Muslims win and they become dominant and powerful, we'll be protected, we'll benefit from the gains. If they lose, then obviously we've made a deal with the enemies of Islam, we'll also be under their protection, we'll gain in that way. So this is the nature of nifaq, of the munafiq. He doesn't decide. He's always hesitant, he's always going in between these two exits. One minute he's a believer, Next minute, he's a kafir. Always coming in and out of both exits. This is the nature of nifaq. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah yastahzi'u bihim wa yamudduhum fi tughyanihim ya'mahun. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mocks them. They said to the kuffar, we are mocking the believers. We are only taking them for a ride. We are deceiving them. But the same word Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses, Allah yastahzi'u bihim wa yamudduhum fi tughyanihim. How does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mock the hypocrites? The Arabs, in their speech, they often use the same word for an action and its consequence, or the same word for the sin and its punishment. They use the same word, it sounds nicer, and it's also a kind of literary style to use the same word. So they use mustahzi'un, Allah uses same word, Allahu yastahzi'u. But the same word has two different meanings. Of course, Allah doesn't mock anybody. Of course, Allah doesn't deceive anybody. But He uses that same word, and the way the mocking happens is in two ways. One is istidraj, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mocks, in inverted commas, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mocks the hypocrites. One is in this dunya, by istidraj. Here Allah says, وَيَمُدُّهُمْ فِي تُغْيَانِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ. مَدَّ يَمُدُّ means He increases them, He extends for them. Meaning what? He gives them enough rope to hang themselves with. You heard that expression? Give the man enough rope to hang himself with. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows them to do what they're doing. So they think they're in safety. Or He increases them. يَمُدُّ means to extend, and it also means to increase. So He extends the time within which they transgress, so they keep on transgressing. But He also increases them in the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will give them power for a little while. He'll give them wealth. He'll give them children. He'll give them the worldly material benefits of this dunya, so that they'll be misguided, meaning they'll be deceived. They'll be thinking, Allah must be pleased with us. If we're successful, we're powerful, we run the world, we run this country, we run this community, Allah, God must be pleased with us. But this is istidraj. Allah is increasing them in their wealth, in their children, in the benefits of this worldly life. Why? So that they are further deceived, in the sense that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take them out. But this is only giving them increase so that their sins are increased and their punishment is increased. And they think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in fact pleased with them when He's not. So Allah says, He يَمُدُّهُمْ فِي تُغْيَانِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ. The second way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mocks, in inverted commas, is in the next world. The same hypocrites, on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ridicule them. He will humiliate them. On the day of judgment, the same hypocrites, when they see the believers traveling across the Sirat, across the bridge to Jannah, and hellfire is below, and it's dark, they will see that the believers have light in front of them with which they cross this bridge. And the hypocrites will say to the believers, give us some of that light, borrow us some of that light. And they will be told, go back. They will be told, get back. They can't go with the believers. But then another door will be opened for them. It will appear like it's a door leading to Jannah, but in fact it's a door leading to hell. And the believers will witness this. And on that day, the believers will be laughing at the hypocrites, just as the hypocrites were mocking and laughing at the believers. And there's many, many other ways described in the Quran how the hypocrites will be mocked at on the day of judgment. So here, Allah yastahzi'u bihim, Allah mocks them in the dunya and in the akhirah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He extends them and increases them in their transgression. Tughyan is transgression, to go beyond the boundary, to go beyond the framework of sharia. Ya'mahoon, wandering blindly, ya'ma, amiya and amiha. This is with a ha. Amiya with a ya or alif is blindness in the eye. Here, amiya, amiha with the ha is blindness of the heart. So the hypocrites, they are wandering blindly because of the blindness of their hearts. They have eyes, they can see what's in front of them, but they don't see with their heart. They can't see guidance, they can't see the light of truth, they can't distinguish between falsehood and truth in reality. So they wander blindly in their transgression because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them as blinded in the heart.
أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوا الضَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَىٰ فَمَا رَبِحَتْ تِجَارَتُهُمْ وَمَا كَانُوا مُهْتَدِينَ.
And these are the people who have purchased misguidance instead of guidance. And therefore, their transaction has not been profitable at all. There's no profit, no gain. And on top of that, they are not guided. So, meaning they preferred, they chose misguidance over guidance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the analogy of a trade or a purchase. When you buy something, the thing you are buying at that moment means much more to you than the thing you are giving away. If you're buying something for £10 or £20, whatever you're buying at that time, whether it's food or something you need, that thing that you're purchasing is more, you are more in need of that. That has more value to you at that moment than the money you give. That's why you're transacting. Otherwise, why would you give away money for something that is worth less than the value of the money you're giving? But these are these people, the hypocrites. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us a description that these people are in utter foolishness. These people have no intellect. That they are buying something which is misguidance. The thing they're buying has no value. And the thing they're giving up, the thing they're choosing over, which is guidance, instead of guidance, they're buying misguidance. So this is how stupid these people are. This is how foolish these people are. That even in their transaction here, they're not making any profit. In fact, they are making a huge loss. That look at them. Instead of choosing guidance, the path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the path to eternal happiness, the path to Jannah, these people are choosing misguidance. They are purchasing misguidance. They are purchasing punishment. And they're purchasing eternal pain and torment in the hellfire. I mean, who would do that? Who of any intellect would choose hellfire, punishment, humiliation over honor and dignity and paradise and reward? Who would do that? Nobody. So these people, not only do they do that, they are not guided. وَمَا كَانُوا مُهْتَدِينَ. They are not guided, but here, muhtad with the ta also means that they didn't try to be guided. They made no effort. They were not. They didn't want to be guided. They did not have any internal effort to be guided as well. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next verse moves on to an example, a mathal. After describing the attributes of the munafiqun, they do this, they do that. Many, many descriptions has come in the last few verses. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make sure that we all understand the nature of hypocrisy, the state of hypocrisy, the consequences of hypocrisy, we understand the true nature of what it is to be a hypocrite. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will now give us a beautiful example, a mathal. And in the Quran, there are many, many of these examples that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives, just to drive the message home, just to make it crystal clear, just to give you a very clear image. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
مَثَلُهُمْ كَمَثَلِ الَّذِي اسْتَوْقَدَ نَارًا فَلَمَّا أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ ذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِنُورِهِمْ وَتَرَكَهُمْ فِي ظُلُمَاتٍ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ صُمٌّ بُكْمٌ عُمْيٌ فَهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ.
Their example is that of one who kindled a fire. But when it illuminated what was around him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took away their light and left them in darkness so they could not see. Now this example is so powerful. This example is so precise, so beautiful. It's amazing. This is only this can only come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wallahi. And I've read this, many of you have read this many times, but when you look into the explanation, how the example fits the description of the munafiqun, you'll be amazed. First of all, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives two examples. One is this example of the one who lights a fire. After these verses, there's another example of the one who walks and it's heavy rain and lightning and thunder. This is just after this example. So the two examples contain what? One contains fire or nur, if you like, and the other one contains water, rain. Now nur and water, light and water. Light is important for guidance, right? Light is important for guidance in a spiritual sense and in a physical sense. If it's dark at night, you can't see without light. And if you're misguided, you don't have access to the light of revelation, you cannot find your way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With water, is a physical source of life. Without water, you'd die. Water is a physical source of life. So it's like the ruh. And these two things, the nur and the ruh, if you like. The nur and the ruh, the Quran has been called both. The Quran is named as ruh. It is that which gives life. And the Quran has also been named nur, that which is light itself. So the example is beautiful because it connects, because all of everything we've been talking about, the munafiqun, is about them being distanced from guidance, about their hearts being dead, not alive. They have no ruh in the heart. There's no illumination in the heart. So this example that is coming now is to do with nur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, imagine a scene in the middle of a forest or outside in the desert. It's at night, completely pitch black. You can't see anything. There is a group of people there. They can't move forward, they can't move backwards, they can't move anywhere. They're stuck. It's complete darkness, they have no light. Then somebody here strikes a light or lights up a fire. What will happen in that darkness when somebody lights up a fire? Everything around these people will become illuminated. You light up a fire, one of those torch-bearing things or whatever it is, everything around you will become illuminated. All of a sudden, out of the pitch blackness, all of a sudden you can see around you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, كَمَثَلِ الَّذِي اسْتَوْقَدَ نَارًا. It's the example of these people with regards to revelation is like the one who has lit a fire. Everything is dark, there's a group of people, but one of them lights a fire. فَلَمَّا أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ ذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِنُورِهِمْ. But when everything is illuminated around them, what happens? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes away their nur, takes away the light. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention light and not fire? Because first Allah said, أَلَّذِي اسْتَوْقَدَ نَارًا. But when he's taking it away, he calls it light. First he says fire, the one who lights a fire. Then it would have been logical to say, then Allah takes away their fire. But he didn't say that. He said, he takes away their nur. Why? Because fire has two qualities. One is a burning quality. It burns. The second quality is it gives off light. It emits light. It illuminates whatever is around it. So in a way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that although this person lights up a fire, and this is like the when they come into Islam, even outwardly, the munafiqun, when they, in front of the believers, they've said, we believe, it's like them lighting that fire. For a second, they can see, they've entered into Islam. Even if it's externally,
outwardly. They haven't entered in the heart, but they had a chance. If they entered and they believed with their heart, they had a chance for that light to be seen. But Allah takes away the light straight away. It's like the munafiqun. They say the shahada, enter into Islam, but straight away, because their heart doesn't believe, that nur of Islam is gone, is finished. Just like this light, this fire, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes away. Why does he say nur? Because the fire has two qualities. It burns and it illuminates. It has the quality of nur and it has the quality of ihraq, to burn. So in a way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, he's taken away the nur by which they would have seen, but he left the quality of burning with them. You see, he left the quality of burning with them, meaning these people will burn in the hellfire. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, reflect on also, he says that, فَلَمَّا أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ ذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِنُورِهِ He says that when this person lights up a fire, then when everything is illuminated around him, أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ that everything is illuminated around him. He didn't say this person is illuminated, meaning he keeps a separation between the person lighting the fire and the light going all around him. Meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this person is not guided, he's not illuminated. Yes, around him there's a separation between the person and what is around him. What is around him is illuminated. Ad-daw is the light that is emitted from the source of nur. It's called ad-daw. So ad-da'at ma hawlahu. The light itself, it's like the light bulb or the light up there. You can see the source, but this, it brightens the whole room. But this light is not going into me. It's separate. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that although it's illuminated all around them, he said, ذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِنُورِهِمْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes away their nur. He didn't say daw. He said he takes away their nur. Why? Because the nur is the source of the light. Nur is the source of illumination. The daw is illumination. Nur is the light itself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken away the source of light, the source of illumination, the source of the daw. He's taken away the actual source. And the Mufassirun, they said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his name, one of his names is Nur itself. He is light himself. He also calls the Quran light, Nur. He calls the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam Nur. He calls Salah Nur. He calls his deen Nur. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes away the light from these people, he's taken away the relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's taken away the nur, illumination of the Qur'an. He's taken away the nur, the illumination, the light of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's taken away the light and illumination of salah. And he's taken away the light and nur of the deen itself from these people. They have no access to it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he's left them, وَتَرَكَهُمْ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ that once he's taken away the source of daw, of illumination, he's taken away the light itself, then he leaves them in darkness. And two things here, darkness, ظُلُمَات is in plural, and nur is singular. Why is nur singular? ظُلُمَات is in plural, many darknesses, if you like. They said because nur is the haqq, is the truth, and the truth is one. The path, siratul mustaqim, the path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. The truth is one. The revelation, this deen is one. But dhulumat, it comes in the batil, the falsehood, the kufr, comes in many shapes and forms and sizes. So therefore, ظُلُمَات, they are left in darkness in plural. And the light has been taken away, which is singular, which is one, which is the truth. And look at the comparison with this example, with everything that's gone before. Everything we were talking about before
is about guidance, huda, and dalala. And here it's about nur and darkness, light and darkness. The light goes with the huda, with the guidance, which we discussed in the previous verses. And the dalala, the misguidance, goes with the darkness. So this is how beautiful this example is. And then further, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that summun bukmun umyun fahum la yarji'un. That not only are they left in darkness, on top of that, they are deaf, they are mute, and they are blind, and therefore they cannot return. If you're in darkness, you have no light, maybe somebody can give you instructions from a distance, and you can hear the instruction, and maybe you can move forward a little bit. But these people, they have no hearing. Maybe you can call out for help if you're in darkness. Maybe you can call out for help until help arrives. But these people, they cannot speak. Maybe the darkness is, yeah, it's pitch black, you can't see. But maybe someone will light something up for you. Or maybe you can try and see, you can try your best to see what's in front of you and move slowly. But these people are blind. They have no access to be guided in this darkness. The three sources of knowledge by which you process information, your hearing, your speech, and your vision and your sight, all three avenues are cut off. They're blocked. They're finished. The hypocrites have no way of returning to what? To returning to the first chance they had when they said the Shahada. When they pretended to enter into Islam, they could have been illuminated and guided. They could have been in the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they chose darkness, they chose misguidance, so therefore they cannot return. All of these three avenues of guidance has been closed. They cannot hear, they cannot speak, and they cannot see. And they also said that this is also related to the heart. All of the avenues of knowledge to the heart is closed off. So what are the lessons that we can take from these few verses? The first thing is that hypocrisy is not something, you know, we should think, subhanAllah, these people, they're in the hellfire. Look at how foolish they are. Look at how much they're transgressing against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at what they did to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look at how they played and mocked the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They're over there and we're believers. We fall into the first four or five ayahs. No, the Umar radiallahu anhu, the Sahaba, the companions, one of the things they feared is hypocrisy. Umar radiallahu anhu, he used to fear because one of the Sahaba, he was given the list of the hypocrites by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the list, the names of the hypocrites in Medina. But this was kept a secret by one of the Sahaba. He didn't disclose it to anybody. But Umar radiallahu anhu, who is, you know, one of the greatest companions, second only to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, who is promised paradise, who is the second Khalifa, Amirul Mu'mineen, the commander of the believers, who sacrificed so much for this deen, he says, am I on that list? He is worried, am I on this list of munafiqun? And the Sahaba, they're worried when they go away from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and their iman decreases because they're away from the source of guidance on this earth through the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they move away and they feel a decrease in their iman, the doubt comes in their mind. They rush back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and one of them says, I've become a hypocrite. How? Because when I'm away from you, my iman goes down. When I come back to you, my iman goes up. I fear I've become a hypocrite. This is how the Sahaba, the best of creation, after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is how they used to fear their state of iman. This is how they used to think that the hypocrites are not other people. It's probably me. It's not this person and that person. It's not that group. It's probably me.
This is the lesson we need to take from here. The Prophet ﷺ described, you may have heard the khutbah here today, he described the characteristics of hypocrisy. And these are found amongst many of us. We should think and reflect on these verses. First of all, we should say Alhamdulillah. We should praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we're not in the group of the definite hypocrites that were described in these verses. That He's given us the tawfiq for our hearts and our tongue to be coherent in declaring the shahada and believing that we're Muslim. But we should not become content and relaxed and thinking, I'm safe. No, we should think that the characteristics of the hypocrites that the Prophet ﷺ described for the believers, that their characteristic is three or four. And some of them are, when they speak, they lie. When they promise, they break their promise. When they're entrusted with an amana, with a trust, they break the trust. They're not faithful to the trust. And when they get angry, they go beyond boundaries. They curse and they go beyond the limits. These are just the characteristics of the hypocrite. Who doesn't lie? Who hasn't broken a promise? Who hasn't broken a trust? Who hasn't lost control when they become angry? But these are the signs of the hypocrite. So as believers, we must be taking lessons from these verses to check ourselves. How much have I been successful? Okay, fine, we may not fit the description here. Even that, the Sahaba were concerned that they may fit the description. But at least we should see these four characteristics. How much of it am I matching that characteristic? How much of those characteristics are actually in me? How much do I lie when I speak? How much do I break my promise when I make a promise? How much do I not fulfill a trust when something is entrusted to me? And how much control do I lose when I get angry? These are four simple things we can all test and check and take ourselves to account. This Quran is for the believers. The hypocrites, they're not going to read this. The lessons in the Quran is for us. The second lesson here is there is something called a hypocrite. These people exist. And we have to be sharp, we have to be alert, we have to be careful. People will come to the Muslim community or to an organization or to the masjid and pretend to be a Muslim, but only to cause us some kind of harm or to work for somebody else for another agenda. And they may be the most pious looking. As they say, وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا. They declare they're believers, they're good Muslims, they're pious. They may be, but we need to be careful. Not to doubt every single person we don't know, but also not to fall into this situation where somebody comes into the community pretending to be your friend or our friend and then doing damage to the community or to the masjid or to an organization or to a group of believers. So we must also be alert on that front. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to take the lessons from these few verses, and inshallah, next week we shall continue with the second example and move on to the next verses, inshallah.